Hello, my dear children. Children, we are going to start with the fresh topic today, and that is Newton's laws. Well, children, Newton's laws talk everything about force. They talk about force from A to Z. These are three in number, and you are already familiar with all the three laws of Newton's. And one more time, we are going to study them today. So let's begin the day with Newton's first law. Well, Newton's first law of motion introduces the concept of force. Newton's second law of motion talks about the magnitude and direction of the force. And Newton's third law would talk about the effect of the force. So everything, the complete information about force is given by Newton's laws. Well, first law. First law is also called as law of inertia. It introduces the concept of force. And how does it introduces the concept of force, or force as a physical quantity? That is obvious from the statement. The statement of the law says that a body in motion would remain in motion. A body at rest would remain at rest until and unless it is acted upon by something. That something is a physical quantity called force. So what does force do? Force brings about a stationary object into motion. Or if an object is in motion, it is brought to rest by a physical quantity called force. A body in motion would not come to rest. It will remain in motion. A body at rest would not move. It will remain in rest until and unless it is acted upon by force. So what does force do? Force simply changes the state of a body. There are two states of body: state of rest or state of motion. Force brings a stationary object into motion, or a moving object into what? State of rest. So force overcomes the inertia. What is this ability? Why do we need a force to bring about the change of state of a body? It is simply because every body possesses inertia. What is inertia? Inertia of a body is its ability to maintain its state. It may be state of rest or state of motion. So there are two types of inertias. Inertia can also be defined as unwillingness to change its state. If a body is in rest, it would try to maintain its state of rest. That is what is inertia of rest. If a body is in motion, it will try to maintain or remain in state of motion. That is called inertia of motion. And force overcomes this inertia. It changes the inertia of rest into motion, or motion into rest. This inertia, which is ability of body to maintain its state, is directly proportional to mass of the body, material content of the body. Greater is the mass of the body, greater is its inertia. Inertia of motion or inertia of rest. Let us understand this with the help of an example. Well, suppose we have a bicycle and a truck. Both are moving with the same speed of, say, 1 meter per second. Both are in motion, both have inertia of motion. Now, if you want to stop a bicycle, you would say, stop, or else you can stand in its way. What will happen? Both of you will collide, and thereafter what happens? That all depends upon your grooming. You may enjoy the fall, or you may start fighting. That is a different matter. So you can afford to jump before a cyclist to stop it. But if a truck is moving with the velocity of 1 meter per second, and you want to stop it, you would say, stop, or else you would say, tata. So why can't you afford to jump before a truck to stop it? Well, the reason is obvious. Truck, on account of greater mass, has greater inertia of motion. On the other hand, bicycle is also in the state of motion and both are moving with the same speed. But since bicycle has smaller mass, it has smaller inertia of motion. Truck has greater mass, has greater inertia of motion. The truck has greater ability to maintain state of motion as compared to bicycle. So you can overcome the small inertia of motion of bicycle on account of its smaller mass by standing in its way. But you cannot overcome the inertia of motion of truck by standing in its way. And if you do that, well, that would be the last day of your life. Please don't ever try that. So I hope you have understood how does inertia depends upon mass. Let us understand it with the help of another example. Suppose we have a breakfast trolley and a car. If you push a breakfast trolley, you expect that the breakfast trolley moves. You have car also, that is also at rest. So by the mere push, you expect a breakfast trolley to move, but by the same push, can you expect that the car is going to move? No, not at all. Why? It is simply because car has greater mass. Trolley has lesser mass. Both are at rest. Both have inertia of rest. But car, on account of greater mass, has greater inertia of rest. Breakfast trolley, on account of smaller mass, has smaller inertia of rest. So this smaller inertia of rest can be overcome by a mere push. But same push cannot move a car. So I hope you have understood how does inertia depends upon mass. So this was first law before you. Well, now let us move on to second law. Newton's second law, which talks about the magnitude and direction of the force, is stated as force. Force acting over a body is equal to rate of change of momentum of body. Or you can say force acting over a body is directly proportional to rate of change of its momentum. So force, which is vector quantity, is nothing but rate of change of momentum, that is change of momentum divided by time in which the change is brought about. Yeah, momentum is a vector quantity, therefore change of momentum is also a vector quantity. This is also a vector quantity, therefore force is also a vector quantity. So direction of change of momentum is the direction of force, and the value of rate of change of momentum is the magnitude of force. Well, as usual, if this time is finite, then this ratio is called as average value of force. And if this time is infinitely small, we call this as instantaneous value of force. The concept of instantaneous and average value is exactly same as the concept of instantaneous speed, velocity, acceleration we have already studied. So this force can be written as, this force vector can be written as, yeah, it is final momentum minus initial momentum divided by time. And this time is what? T, finite. We call it as what? Average value of force. So change of momentum, direction is the direction of force, and the value of rate of change of momentum is the value of force. Remember, this is average value. If we write this force as dp by dt, that is first order differential of momentum with respect to time, then this notation of the force is called as instantaneous value of force. Well, let us say we have a body of mass m moving with initial velocity u acquires velocity v after time t. So if we have a body of mass m moving with initial velocity u, and this body acquires velocity v after time t. So what is change of momentum? See, the change of momentum, well, the force is going to be equal to what? Force is going to be equal to final momentum minus initial momentum upon time. What is final momentum? Final momentum is momentum after time t. And what is that? M into v. Remember, v is a vector quantity. This is final momentum. What is initial momentum? M into what? U vector. And the time in which this change is brought about is what? T. We know f is equal to what? Pf minus pi upon t. So final momentum of the body is going to be mass into final velocity. Initial momentum of the body is going to be mass into initial velocity. And the time in which the change is brought about is t. You can see that this m comes out common from the numerator. And what do we get? V minus u upon t. We all know that V vector, that is final velocity vector, velocity at an instant t, is what? Initial velocity plus A times t. That means V minus u upon t. Upon t is going to be A. And if we substitute this value here, what do we get F as? We get F vector as mass into acceleration vector. So F is equal to ma. This is consequence. This is consequence of second law. This is consequence of Newton's second law. So, what is Newton's third law? Newton's third law of motion talks about effect of force. This is very popular law. Almost everybody knows this law, even without knowing physics. So, what is this very popular Newton's third law? Well, every action has equal and opposite reaction. So what is this action? This action is force. So every acting force has equal and opposite. Every acting force, that is action, every acting force has equal and opposite reaction force. So every action has equal and opposite reaction. So what is this action? This action is a force, and the action is also a force. So the statement is every acting force has equal and opposite reaction force. If these are two bodies, one and two, if body 1 applies force over 2, this is force applied over 2 due to 1. This is action. Then what is going to happen? Over body 1 is going to act force what? F12. Force. This is reaction force. So if body 1 applies force, F21 over 2, then body 2 applies equal and opposite force over body 1. So this F12 force, that is force acting on 1 due to 2, is minus times force acting over 2 due to 1. Or you can change the sides. F21 is equal to minus times F12. If one is action, the other is what? Reaction. Now there are three immediate properties of action reaction forces. Action, reaction, forces. So there are three immediate properties, and these three immediate properties of action reaction forces are very, very important. Well, these action reaction forces are always in what? Pair. These action reaction forces are always in pair. The second property is these forces are always equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. Opposite in direction. So both the forces are always equal in magnitude and they are opposite in direction. And the third property, which is very, very important, the third property which is very, very important is these forces act over, these forces, that is action-action forces, act over, very, very important, they act over different bodies. This is property number three, which is the most important property. So the three immediate properties of action-reaction forces are, number one, both the forces are always in pair, both the members of the pair are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction, and they act over different bodies. They act over different bodies. If the action of 1 over 2 is towards right, then the action of 2 over 1 would be what? Towards left over this body. The action is over this body, reaction is over this body. So both these action-reaction forces act over different bodies. There is a paradox which is at times asked in your exams, and that paradox is explained by property number 3. Well, when we apply a force, the paradox is stated like this. When we apply a force over body, that is action, equal and opposite forces applied by the body in the opposite direction. So when there are two equal and opposite forces, their algebraic sum or the vector sum will come out to be zero. That means there is, if we find out the algebraic sum of two equal and opposite forces, it comes out to be zero. That means there is no force. If there is no force, then why should there be motion? You apply force over a body, body moves. But whatever force you apply over body, same reaction acts over your body. So there are two forces which are equal and opposite. Their algebraic sum will come out to be zero. That means there is no net force. When there is no net force, why should there be motion? That is the paradox. Well, the explanation to this paradox lies here in this statement number 3, which is property number 3. We apply force over body, that is force acting over that body, and the body moves by virtue of that force. The reaction of the body is over us. It is not acting over same body. Action force is over one body, reaction force is over this body. So these action, there is net force F21 over this body, and there is net force over one, over body number 1. So these action-reaction forces, since act over different bodies, therefore we cannot find out their algebraic sum and say zero. So where lies the fault? The fault lies in algebraic sum, which we say at zero. Algebraic sum of the two equal and opposite forces would be zero when both the forces act over a single body. If both the forces act toward a given body, if this is a body, if we apply force F and force F, the two equal and opposite forces act toward the same body. In that case, their algebraic sum is zero, and that algebraic sum is justified. But if the forces are acting over different bodies, two equal and opposite forces, they are acting over different bodies, then their algebraic sum cannot be found out and said as zero. So algebraic sum is not zero. There is net force acting over the body over which we apply force, and there is net force acting upon us also. So we feel the reaction as the result, we need to apply force, and the body moves with that force, whatever force acts over the body. So there is motion because of the net force acting over the body, and algebraic sum is not justified. That is the explanation of the paradox which I have just stated. Well, there are innumerable examples of action-reaction forces all around you. A gun recoils, we are sitting in a bus, and if all of a sudden the bus stops, moving bus stops, the passenger in the bus, all of them, well, they fall forward, they experience a push in the forward direction. And if all of a sudden the bus starts moving, then passengers in the bus, they all experience a push in the backward direction. And there are innumerable number of examples. But there are certain very specific examples related with physics which I am going to discuss right now. So what are these action-reaction forces? These three immediate properties are going to be used. So the most specific examples of action-reaction forces are what? Tension. Tension in string. Tension in string. What is string? String is a cord which connects a body from rigid surface or two bodies. And the string which I am going to discuss here, is going to be what? Is going to be massless and inextensible. So the tension in the string is an example of action-reaction force. Suppose this is a rigid support and we tie a string here and hang a mass here with this string. So tension in the string is the example of action-reaction force. And action-reaction force are what? Always in pair. Yeah, they are always in pair. Yeah. They are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. T. See, they are equal in magnitude and they are opposite in direction. And they act over different bodies. This tension acts over this rigid support in the downward direction. The same tension acts over this mass where? In the upward direction. Well, this tension may be in the string which connects two masses. Like this. If the masses are moving, say, in any direction, say, the masses are moving towards right. Remember, the string is inextensible. Well, there will be tension in the string. The tension in the string is going to be shown how? T, in pair. See, the tension is in pair. Both the members of pair are what? Equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. And they act over different bodies. This T acts over this mass towards right and this T acts over this mass towards left. This is a pulley. This is a massless and a smooth pulley. And the string passes over it and there are two masses hung from it over the ends of the string. What is tension? Tension is an example of action-reaction force. So the tension is always going to be what? It is always going to be in pair. See how it is being made. Both the members of the pair are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. And they act over different bodies. This tension acts over this pulley in tangentially downward direction. And this tension acts over this mass, say, in upward direction. Same way here also, this tension acts over this mass in the upward direction. And the same tension acts over this pulley in tangentially downward direction. So tension is an example of action-reaction force, tension in string. And remember, this tension, when we make the tension in the string, we have to just bear in mind, tension is always made. Just remember the keyword, away from, it could be rigid support. It could be mass or it could be pulley. The tension is going to be same simply because the string we have taken is massless. So how do we make all these directions? Just bear in mind this keyword. Tension is always made away from the mass, away from the rigid support and away from pulley. Like here, tension is, this is the string, one end is connected with rigid support, other end is connected with mass. So tension here is shown away from rigid support, away from mass. Away from mass, away from mass. Tension here is what? Away from pulley, this is away from mass, this is away from pulley, this is away from mass. So if we bear in mind this concept, then we would be able to make the tension correctly. And in this case, the tension satisfies all these three properties of action-reaction forces. The other example of action-reaction forces is what? Other example of action-reaction forces is reaction. Reaction from surface. If you are standing over a surface, whatever force you exert over the surface, same force is exerted by surface upon you. If you are sitting over a chair, whatever force you exert over chair, same force is exerted by the chair upon you. So this is reaction from a surface. Whatever force we exert over surface, this is body lying over surface. Whatever force this body is going to exert over surface, of course that force is going to be what? Its weight, if this is horizontal surface. Then what is this? The surface is going to exert a force over body and that is going to be what? Say N, normal reaction. and this n is equal to what mg. They are equal, they are in pair. This is action, this is its reaction. So what is action? Action is mg, reaction is n. Both are in pair, both are equal in magnitude and opposite interaction. Yeah, both the values are what? Same, mg. And of course they are in opposite direction. And they act over different bodies. The force, the weight of this mass acts over the surface downward. And the reaction of the surface acts over this mass in the upward direction. There are many examples. Friction. Friction is also an example of what? Action-reaction force. Friction is also an example of action-reaction force. If this body is moving over a surface, this body is moving over a rough surface, say towards right. If this body is moving over this rough surface towards right, and this rough surface is in turn placed over a smooth surface like this. This is a smooth surface. This is smooth horizontal surface. A smooth horizontal surface. This is, say, body 1 of mass m. This is body of mass m. If this body tends to move over, this surface is rough. This is rough. If we move this body towards right, well, this body would be able to move only when the force of friction, it overcomes the force of friction. So the force of friction of this surface acts over this body in the backward direction. This is force of friction. And reaction of this force of friction acts over this lower body towards right, this F. So this force, this body is going to move towards right. If it is going to move towards right, if the motion is what? If we try to move the body towards right, then what will happen? The body would move towards right only when the force of friction of the surface is overcome, that is in the backward direction. And reaction of this is where? Over this lower body towards right. Like if there are a number of books kept in the shelf and you try to pull out a book, what happens? You pull out a book, but other books, they also try to come out. The book which we pull out, that book of course comes out. But along that book, the books which are kept above and books which are kept below, they are also pulled out. Why? Because the reaction of the force of friction which we overcome in pulling a particular resistor is the reaction of that acts over the upper and lower book in the forward direction. Like this. So if we pull this book, this lower book also tries to move in this direction with the net force F. So friction is also an example of action-reaction force. So there are a number of examples, but these specific examples are going to be used in this very chapter. So with this, we come to the end of Newton's laws of motion today. In the next class, we'll talk about free body diagram and we'll study the actual motion of the bodies over horizontal inclined plane and say along gravity, along vertical. So we are going to move into the real world of numericals in the next lecture. So until we meet again, thank you and God bless you all.